Okay, in this video we're going to begin a new topic dealing with the conservation of momentum. So previously we talked about another important conservation law, conservation of mass. So here we're going to use the same basic ideas but apply them to momentum. And in this case we're talking about linear momentum as opposed to angular momentum. We can also write a conservation law for angular momentum, and sometimes that's important when you're talking about characterizing deformations of fluid elements in more complex fluids. But for us, the conservation of linear momentum is a starting point, and it gives us some very important results that will help us to analyze many of the flow fields of interest to us in this course. And so again, going back to the definition of a conservation law, we can apply it to that general definition to the case of linear momentum. And so we can state that the rate of change of momentum in a control volume, CV, is equal to the rate of inflow of momentum into the control volume minus the rate of outflow of momentum away from the control volume plus the sum of the forces that are acting on the control volume. So this statement, this general conservation law, is actually just a statement of Newton's second law of motion, which states that the sum of the forces is equal to the time rate of change of momentum. Normally we think of momentum is mass times velocity, mv. So normally we consider cases in physics, you may remember, where mass, we consider that to remain constant. So it just becomes, m, the time rate of change of momentum becomes mass times the time rate of change of velocity, which is ma. So F equals ma is an expression of Newton's second law, maybe more familiar to us, but the more general case is that the sum of the forces is the time rate of change of momentum. But in addition, on a control volume, we also, because we're dealing with flow, we need to account for inflow and outflow of momentum through the control volume. So in order to do that, you may remember from some of the earlier videos where we talked about the basic definition of viscosity and shear stress, the idea that we need to be able to describe forces that are acting on a surface or a fluid element, the surface of a fluid element. If we imagine a surface or a differential sized piece of fluid inside the larger volume, we want to be able to describe the forces or the stresses that are acting on this fluid element. And the observation we can make is to notice that the orientation of both the force and the surface of the fluid element are important in order to fully describe these interactions. And you may remember that we can describe the orientation of surfaces in terms of a normal vector, n, which is a unit vector that's normal to the surface. So the way to think about it is, when you're driving in a car and you put your hand out the window, if your hand is up and down, the surface of your hand is up and down, so it's perpendicular to the ground. You can really feel the wind force because it's hitting your hand, straight on. But if you turn your hand sideways, so it's parallel to the ground, then the wind is going over the surface of your hand, so it's more of a shearing force. So the orientation of that surface is relative to the direction of the force is what we need to describe in order to talk about these stresses in the fluid. And so both of these quantities, both the force and the surface orientation, are vector quantities. They are just, the force has a magnitude and direction, and the surface is described by a unit vector to give us a way to locate its orientation in space. So given that that's the case, we need to keep track of two quantities, each of which has three components. So the forces are stresses that are associated with these forces and surface orientations are going to be described by a different quantity called a tensor. So a tensor has nine components, and so that includes the information from both of these vector quantities. It's a quantity that's able to represent information from both of these vector quantities. So remember that we talked about, when we were talking about viscosity, the shear stress we write as the Greek letter tau. So tau sub yx indicates that a stress is acting on a surface that is oriented with a normal vector in the y direction due to a force acting in the x direction. So that's what this index notation means. It's the stress on a surface whose normal is in the y direction due to a force in the x direction. So the first index represents the surface orientation, the second represents the direction of the force. And remember, stress is force per unit area. So pressure, you know, we think of pressure as force per unit area. That's a special case where the force per unit, the force is acting normal to the surface. Okay, so a tensor, I'm going to denote with two squiggle lines under it. A vector, remember, just has one. So the stress tensor includes nine components, because this represents all possible combinations of the force direction and the surface orientation. So all these components in this matrix are represented by this quantity tau with the two lines underneath. And this is what we call the stress tensor. So instead of three components like a vector, it has nine components. Okay, so now let me draw a cube here to show some things about how we talk about these stresses. So this is a shape, a simple shape that has surfaces that happen to be oriented in each of these directions. Relative to a Cartesian coordinate system, x, y, and z, which the axes I've shown here. So I can write on this face tau xx. So this is the stress on a surface whose normal is in the x direction due to a force in the x direction, tau xx. And so this is a normal stress, right? So this would be something similar to what we think of as pressure. Okay, I could also write another component here. So tau xy. So again, this is a stress on a surface whose normal is in the x direction. So the same surface we're talking about, but due to a force that's in the y direction. So this would represent tau xy. So it's a shearing force. It's acting parallel to the surface. And similarly, I can write another third component, tau xz. So this is the stress, again, on a surface whose normal is in the x direction, due to a force in the z direction. So that's another component that is a shear stress. So you can see how these indices help me orient or describe these different stresses and how they relate to both the orientation of the surface that I'm talking about and the direction of the force that's applied. So I can do the same thing in the other direction. So on the top face, this face has a normal in the y direction. So the normal stress is tau yy. And then I have two shearing components, tau yx and tau yz, that would be due to forces acting in the x and z directions. And on this front face, this has a normal in the z direction. So I have components tau zz, which is the normal stress, and then shear stress components tau zy and tau zx due to forces that are acting in the y and the x directions, respectively. Okay, so this sort of shows the orientations of these stresses and how they relate to both the surface orientation and the direction in which a force is applied. Okay, so now let's look at one plane in this shape and look at what forces would be associated with a particular direction. So I'm just going to draw in the xy plane. We have some point xyz, and I'm just going to look at the xy projection of this. And so I can draw a box around this point with sides delta x and delta y. You know, and z is coming, you know, into or out of the out of the screen here. Now with this surface arrangement, we can think about looking at the forces acting on these surfaces in sort of the same way that we used to talk about conservation of mass. So at this surface here, a force in the x direction would produce a normal stress, and that normal stress at this surface I could represent as tau xx, which would be mapped to this point xyz in space, plus the differential change in tau xx with respect to x times the distance from the center to the space, which is delta x over 2. So I'm mapping this the value of the shear of the normal stress at this point out to this surface that's a differential distance away. Similarly, I can make the same analysis on the left-hand face. So I have tau xx, the value associated with the point xyz, mapped out to this left-hand face. So plus the partial derivative of tau xx with respect to x times the distance minus delta x over 2 from the center to this face, to the left-hand face. So now I can look at the top surface. So this surface has a normal vector in the y direction, and I'm considering forces acting in the x direction. So the component of interest here is tau yx plus the rate of change of tau yx with respect to y times the distance to the from the center to the top surface, delta y over 2. And on the bottom face, I have the point value tau yx plus the rate of change of tau yx with respect to y times the distance from the center to the bottom face minus delta y over 2. Okay, so now I can also think about this front face, which would be on the top of this surface. So here, again, the normal vector to the surface is in the z direction, and I'm talking about forces in the x direction. So I have tau zx plus the rate of change of tau zx with respect to z times the distance from the center to the top face, delta z over 2, or to the front face. And then behind here, it's hard to represent because I just drew a 2D projection, but the backside of this, if you imagine the backside of the surface, would be tau zx plus the partial derivative of tau zx with respect to z times the distance minus delta z over 2. Okay, so these are all the components associated with a force acting in the x direction on this this kind of a control volume. Now, notice that I sort of took some liberties in assigning directions to these arrows. Some of them are pointing left to right, and some of them are pointing right to left. Why is that? Okay, so for these arrows that are pointing, I guess, in the negative direction, right, they're pointing toward the negative x direction. These reflect a sign convention that we have when we talk about stresses. And that sign convention is such that a stress is considered positive when it's exerted by a fluid of greater first subscript in the stress tensor notation on a fluid of lesser first subscript in the stress tensor notation. So let me show you what I'm talking about here. The point is that we need to have some convention to define, you know, what's positive and what's negative. And so this is what's generally accepted as the convention to describe that. So let me show you what I'm talking about. So again, this is kind of a simplified view of this 2D projection of this element. So I have two, if I look at just the normal, the components on the x face, so I have tau xx on the right-hand side and tau xx on the left-hand side. So let's look at the right-hand side. So my control volume is here, and I've sort of shaded it in to indicate that. So the stress on this surface of the control volume is exerted by the fluid out here. So the fluid out here that's acting on this control volume has a position that it's a greater value of x, right? It's further out in the x direction than the position of this surface. So this fluid out here at greater x is acting on a surface of lesser x. Okay, so therefore, by convention, this would be a positive stress. And similarly, let's look at this surface on the left-hand side. So the fluid over here on the far left is acting on this surface that is a little bit further to the right. So by our convention, then this fluid of lesser x is acting on a surface of greater x. So then, by our convention, this would be considered a negative stress. Okay, so this is just a convention that people agreed on. You have to define positive and negative somehow, and this is the way that is generally accepted to describe these stresses. So once everyone agrees, that's how we're going to do it. Then that makes it easier to proceed and come up with a common common set of equations to describe these kinds of things.